human toll of these cavalier policies is enormous. For instance, Lisa Crowe, who is only 43 years old, has stage 4 breast cancer and has been given 12 months to live. She cannot dress or wash herself and is confined to a wheelchair when she has enough energy to get up at all. After much advocacy, the warden agreed to home confinement, but the regional office would not approve release so she could go home to die with her family. The reason given to a woman who is bedridden, who can barely speak because of a metastasized lump in her throat, was that she might start trafficking OxyContin during her last months on this earth. This is not an oversight or a question of a release request falling through the cracks. Ms. Crowe has many advocates, including her Congressman Representative Danny Davis, who has made inquiries into her case. The BOP is actively refusing to release a dying woman. We received an update today that she is now struggling, now not to strangle in her saliva. There are three ways, in closing, a person can get early release. One way is a transfer to home confinement under the Elderly Prisoner Pilot Program for those who meet the criteria. Another way is release under the Attorney General's March 26 and April 3rd directives. And then there's compassionate release by court order. Under the First Step Act, a person may petition the sentencing court directly for release based on extraordinary and compelling circumstances after exhausting his or her administrative remedies. The statute is awkwardly written, but appears to mandate that a person petition the warden, and if no answer is received after 30 days, the person can file a motion for release. If the warden denies the request within 30 days, then the person has to go through the administrative appeals process, which can take months. People who are vulnerable to COVID-19 cannot wait 30 days, especially if the answer, whether yes or no, means no more waiting, means more waiting. If the warden agrees, the release still has to be approved by other parts of the BOP. If the warden says no, then an administrative appeal is required. If the warden says nothing, then the person must draft a motion and wait for the court to act. Between 2014 and 2018, 81 people died while they had compassionate release requests pending, and that was before COVID-19 struck. One crucial step in saving incarcerated people who are vulnerable to COVID-19 would be to remove the exhaustion requirement from the First Step Act. Senators Schatz and Durbin have introduced the Emergency Grace Act to streamline the compassionate release process. The standard for granting compassionate release, extraordinary and compelling, is high. The exhaustion requirement makes compassionate release essentially unobtainable. But Congress wanted our people to have a viable path to release during this pandemic. As I've outlined, the BOP is unwilling or unable to provide one. As we continue at the National Council to be on the front lines in a fight to protect the human beings who are incarcerated during this COVID-19 pandemic, we will continue to be at the receiving end for the phone calls from the families and documenting the desperate pleas from the women themselves. And we will continue to do all we can to provide them with the support they need, notwithstanding our overstretched staffing capacity and budget. But we need help. Congress can help to fix this, and we believe Congress has a moral responsibility to do so. Thank you again for this opportunity.
Thank you very much. Angela Caldwell.
Thank you.
Okay.
This past March, when COVID-19 really started hitting the United States, people started asking whether they would be going to school, whether their offices would be shut down, whether they would lose their jobs. My family started asking whether we would lose our father. My dad's name is Thomas Balsiger, and he is incarcerated at the La Tuna prison camp just outside of my hometown of El Paso, Texas. The camp is a minimal security facility with mostly elderly, nonviolent, first-time offenders. There isn't even a fence around the campus. The inmates there are all extremely low risk for recidivism. Otherwise, they wouldn't have qualified for a camp. These men are not hardened criminals. They pose no danger to the public. They made mistakes and are trying to pay their debts to society quietly and honorably. My dad is 67 years old and has been diagnosed with advanced coronary artery disease. He suffers from high blood pressure and hypertension. According to the CDC, this places him in the highest risk group for dying with COVID. In late March, he suffered his fourth heart attack and was denied appropriate medical care. When he asked the medical staff to protect him from COVID early on, they laughed at him and sent him back to his cell. My father was identified almost 2 months ago as high risk for contracting the virus. 2 months ago, this government acknowledged that my father has a target on his back. But 3 days after the Attorney General's directive to the BOP, the warden told these men that none of them would be getting out of his prison, and that if they died, it would be their own fault for committing a crime in the first place. My father applied for a transfer to home confinement immediately after the Attorney General's directive on March 29th. 2 weeks later, he signed his transfer papers. My mother was contacted by prison administration, and her home was determined suitable for home confinement, and we started to grieve. A week later, on April 20th, my father's transfer was denied. Apparently, there was a new requirement that he had to have served 50% of his sentence. And because of that arbitrary threshold that has nothing to do with COVID-19, because of this betrayal, my father's hopes for protection from his government were shattered. My family was devastated. My mother stopped sleeping. On April 29th, we requested a compassionate release. And on April 30th, we restarted the request for home confinement. This time, our efforts initially appeared to be successful. 2 days later, my father signed his transfer papers again. A few days after that, my mother passed another home inspection, and we could breathe again. My father was coming home, where we could protect him from the virus better than the BOP. But this past Monday, 4 days ago, my father received notice that his compassionate release was denied because the prison was using other means to protect his safety. But the next day, Tuesday, we got word that his transfer to home confinement had been denied. Again, that's three denials. As if this weren't bad enough, my father, who has a perfect conduct record and is a model prisoner, has been placed in solitary confinement twice in the last 2 months. However, both times he was not charged with a violation. His record remains spotless. But both times happened to be on the same day that I arranged interviews between him and the Washington Post. Both times, the warden placed a 67-year-old man with a serious heart condition in a roach-infested cell to block him from speaking to the press. And my family got to go to bed that night with visions of my father lying on a prison floor, ribs bruised from being kicked, clutching at his chest. My father has been begging the BOP for safety for 2 months, and we have been denied three times. But others have been released. So what are the rules? If you're famous, you get released. If you're from a prison that has already killed many of its inmates because of the outbreak, you get released. And if this discussion results in my father's release, then what does that mean? That your daughter has to appear in front of Congress for you to be treated like a human being? What does it mean for the other inmates at La Tuna who are victims of unconscionable abuses, whose families cannot speak for them? I am here because of my privilege. I'm here because I'm white, I'm educated, but most importantly, in the case of La Tuna, because I speak English. You see, El Paso is a border town. Most of the inmates at La Tuna are from American families who don't look like families in the rest of the country. In El Paso, many American families only speak Spanish. Where I grew up, you'd better be bilingual or you might not be able to order dinner. So what do these families do? How do they protect their fathers from a COVID outbreak in prison if they can't even read the website? The answer is that it's not their job. I shouldn't be here. It is not the job of the families to protect the incarcerated. That is the job of the BOP. These men and women were given prison sentences. That's the deal. The BOP is not entitled to subject them to further punishment, and they are certainly not entitled to subject them to death. I am here to expose the cruelty and deceit of the BOP. The BOP claims that they are following the guidance of the CDC and acting expeditiously to protect the incarcerated from the virus. But they haven't helped my dad in 2 months. 10 guards at his prison are telling inmates that they tested positive for the virus at a nearby hospital. 20 inmates with COVID symptoms have been hidden away in solitary confinement, and La Tuna continues to refuse testing. The BOP is lying to the public, and they are lying to you. They have no interest in saving lives. They are killing our family members and emotionally torturing us. Please hold them accountable.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you sharing your story and other guests that have spoken at this roundtable. Thank you. Thank you much for your time. So we're now going to open the floor for questions. And as I mentioned in the beginning, in the interest of time, I ask that all members to limit themselves to one or two questions. I do have a little bell that I will ring if you go on beyond 5 minutes, but with respect to everyone, we want every member to have a chance to ask questions. And we are going to start with our chairman, who I know has a statement as well as his time for questions.
Well, thank you very much. And I do have a statement before the questions. It is critical that members of this committee gather today, albeit virtually instead of in person, to discuss the urgent matter of COVID-19 in our country's prisons and jails. Many members have worked diligently to bring attention to this issue, to engage in oversight of the administration's terrible response and actions. The response of the administration has been inadequate in not releasing, as we've heard, in not releasing nonviolent prisoners that Congress has given them the authority to release, prisoners whose lives are endangered, in not having proper social distancing in prisons, in not providing personal protective equipment to staff. All of this threatens the lives of the prisoners, it threatens the lives of the staff, it threatens the people in the communities, because the prisons can become vectors for the pandemic. The result is a high rate of death and infection in and around the prisons. And this will only get worse if the Bureau of Prisons and Department of Justice continues on this terrible course. The committee has engaged in oversight concerning this issue at the federal, state, and local levels. Close to my district, I have taken a particular interest in the disturbing situations at the Metropolitan Detention Center in Brooklyn and the Metropolitan Correctional Center in Manhattan, those are both federal prisons, and the outbreak of COVID-19 among inmates and staff at Rikers Island. I especially want to recognize the efforts of the Congressional Black Caucus under the leadership of its chair, Karen Bass, in focusing on this issue and holding virtual town halls to discuss it, one of which included the participation of our speaker, Nancy Pelosi. I've also worked with Representative Bass in her capacity as chair of the Crime Subcommittee to write repeatedly to the Justice Department on several occasions to urge aggressive action with respect to prisoners held in the Bureau of Prisons and detainees held by the Marshal Service. The Attorney General, unfortunately, has been slow to act. We've heard from some of our witnesses that they've been quite perverse, not taking the necessary action to use to an appropriate degree the expanded home confinement authority granted to the DOJ under the CARES Act, which was enacted in March. In fact, the sparing use of this authority has been replete with confusing policy changes and resulting heartache for families of prisoners who are vulnerable to COVID-19 infection. That is why we included additional authority in the HEROES Act recently passed by the House. To address the situation in federal prisons, we included the Emergency Community Supervision Act, authored by our colleague, Representative Jeffries, to direct the release of vulnerable prisoners who do not pose a risk of harming others to community supervision, in addition to other changes in federal law, such as the expansion of elder release during this emergency period. The HEROES Act also includes a bill that I introduced called the Correctional Facility Emergency Response Act to help address this crisis in state and local prisons and jails. This bill would utilize grant funding to incentivize the release of particularly vulnerable prisoners who are not at risk of harming others and to fund prevention and treatment of COVID-19 in local prisons and jails. We've been active legislatively, and we will continue to be vigilant in conducting oversight of what is going on in our prisons and jails across the United States. As we've heard from our guest today, the course of action by the Bureau of Prisons, by various people working there, the wardens, by the Attorney General, has been not only inadequate, it has been contrary to the will of Congress, contrary to the intent of the laws we have passed, in apparently very deliberately endangering the lives of inmates, of prisoners, I would add of staff and of people who live in the vicinity of prisons. I'm glad we heard from our guest. I have a couple of questions. For Mr. Patton, in October last year, you testified before the Crime Subcommittee and detail the conditions of prisoners endured at the MDC, the Metropolitan Detention Center in Brooklyn, in early 2019 because of the lack of heating during the coldest part of that year. During the hearing, the BOP director at the time, Dr. Kathleen Hawke Sawyer, assured us that the BOP had implemented systems to ensure they were better prepared to handle emergencies in the future. A lot has happened since that testimony, and we are now in the middle of a pandemic. Has anything changed for the better at MDC since the time you testified before us last October? Have they made improvements? How have they been handling the current emergency?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Unfortunately, the conditions at the MDC, as well as the MCC and several others, make those conditions from a year ago look like child's play. The state of the living conditions right now for our clients are just awful. They are locked down for enormous periods of time. The conditions are completely unsanitary. They live in constant fear that they're going to contract a deadly disease. And they have gotten, we heard such compelling testimony from Ms. Caldwell about her father. I wish that was the exception, but it's really the rule. People are told one thing, they get their hopes up. They hear public pronouncements from the BOP and DOJ, and they think, well, surely help is on the way. People are going to do the right thing. And then they're told that they qualify for some sort of release, and their families get their hopes up, only the next day to have BOP change its mind, and you're locked back down in your cell and sometimes for days at a time. The conditions at the MDC and MCC are terrible. They're vermin infested. People are crowded by the dozens into housing units. They sleep in bunks that are just a few feet apart, and you can have 50, 70 people in a housing unit sharing maybe one or two working toilets or sinks or showers. It's just built for contagion. And people live in constant fear, not to mention being shut off from the rest of the world. There is no social or legal visitation. There are very limited means to communicate with the outside world, whether it's by phone or email. It's extremely limited right now. So it's just an awful, awful place to be.
Well, thank you. I have one question for Ms. Caldwell, and let me express my concern and sympathy for the situation of your father. As you know, BOP, the Bureau of Prisons, reports the numbers of prisoners infected with COVID-19 on its website. Has your father shared with you any of the views of those inside as to whether those numbers are accurate? Whether the way BOP has publicly depicted the situation is accurate. In other words, do their reports reflect what your father knows is going on over there?
We have heard reports from my father. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Sorry. We've heard reports from my father that 10 of the correctional officers have tested positively for COVID, but not at the prison. They tested at a nearby hospital. As for the prisoners, there is no information. None of the prisoners, of course, have been tested, but they are reporting high numbers of COVID symptoms.
Thank you. I yield back, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, thank you, Mr. Chair. Out of deference to my colleagues, I'll hold my questions until the end. Representative Sheila Jackson Lee.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you to our chair of the full committee and of the subcommittee for this roundtable, which I believe is extremely important. Let me very briefly put some numbers in the record that obviously need updating, but it shows in comparison of the devastation that our inmates are facing. In April, late April, 620 federal inmates and 357 BOP staff confirmed positive results for COVID-19 nationwide. And as indicated, over about 50 plus have died. As a comparison, in the state of Texas, 44,000 approximately were tested and 2,455 were found to be positive of COVID-19. And in our juvenile facilities, we have found that there's been very limited testing. 70% of incarcerated youth are nonviolent, but a number of them have been found to be COVID-19 positive. So I want to raise the question of how these facilities are really petri dishes and really are devastating for individuals who are in fact human beings. I think that is a real question of why I was motivated to push for the testing of the Harris County Jail, where about 770 were tested and about 300 were positive. So I want to raise the question and first of all, say to Ms. Caldwell how heinous an action that has occurred to both your family and your father. Very quickly, I want to try to understand the regional construct, which means that inmates cannot depend upon decisions being made by the warden when another oversight interferes and denies a human being their right under the present laws, also as evidenced by the CARES Act. Would you comment on that? And then I would appreciate my second question is for Ms. James and Mr. Patton to talk about the undermining of the Patton score, which seems to change over and over again, the Patton score, which from my perspective needs to be addressed legislatively along with the issue of exhaustion of remedies. Ms. Caldwell, I'd appreciate it. Thank you very much.
I apologize, ma'am. Can you please repeat the question for me?
The question was, I understand that your father was approved by the warden, and I'm sorry for these terrible conditions that you were living in, or he was living in, and then it was ultimately overruled by the regional office. Can you explain what that does to families when you cannot rely upon a consistent decision-making that impacts families so devastatingly?
The impact it has on us, I wish there was a stronger word than devastating. We can't sleep. We are in a constant state of vigilance. I think Mr. Patton was describing, we hear good news from a warden and we get our hopes up, then we get a denial, and then we hear good news from the warden and then we get a denial, and it's crushing us. I'm sure it's crushing every family member that goes through this. We thought he was coming home so that we could protect him, and his third denial came, and we are completely at, I'm sorry, we are at a loss. We don't know who to trust. We don't know if we can trust our own government. We don't know if we can trust the warden. We don't trust anyone.
Thank you. Thank you. The Patton question? Ms. James or Ms. Patton? On the issue of the Patton changing continuously and negative impact?
I'm happy to address that. I know Ms. James knows it well, too. And frankly, I know that Chair Bass and Chair Nadler know this issue very well because they've written to the director about it. For those who don't know, Patton is a risk assessment scoring system. It's brand new and frankly seems like it's still in some sort of evolving development, although there's not very much transparency behind it. So there's a lot we don't know. But what we do know, consistent with our fears when it was developed, is that it has incredibly racially disparate impacts. The scoring system purports to place people in various risk categories, and they're now using that as part of their home confinement transferring criteria. It's not what the tool was meant or designed to do. It's not even clear that pattern is useful or effective for the purpose for which it was actually designed, but now they're using it for this entirely different purpose and saying that only people who score at a minimum level will be considered a priority for home detention. I mean, we know that similarly situated Black males will only fall into that category 7% of the time as compared to 30% of white men. So it's problematic in many ways. We could hold an entire hearing just on the use of pattern for any number of reasons, much less using it during a crisis like this, which is entirely inappropriate.
Thank you.
Thank you,
sir. Representative Jimmy.
Yes, good afternoon. And I want to again join my colleagues in thanking our guests. The information that we are hearing today is just simply devastating. We have been working on this issue for a while now, and believe me, we will continue to do so. Ms. Caldwell, every story that I've heard has just been unbelievable, but you said the warden had approved your father's release being assigned at home, but yet the regional group disapproved. What did the regional office see that the warden, who's there every day, did not see or failed to see?
It's my understanding that it actually was not the regional office that denied his transfer. It was the central office. It was the DC office that denied his transfer. We actually just learned the reason this morning, and the reason was that he had not served 50% of his sentence.
Okay, and what did they say, though, about the extenuating circumstances of your father's health? We understand that.
Nothing.
There was no mention of that.
Nothing.
Okay. All right. Thank you so very much. Ms. James and Mr. Patton, you both just kind of talked about the reapplying, the confusing, inconsistent, changing policies, which is quite very disturbing. And I understand there is a scoring system, but Ms. James, if the criteria changes, it seems like every other day or every week, is there a new scoring system, or are they just making the rules up depending on who's at work that day?
Well, it would appear, Congresswoman, that is exactly what is happening. The criteria is changing based on the reports that we're receiving directly from the women inside on a consistent, regular and consistent basis, and sometimes a few times within the same day. And so they are confused in terms of what the criteria is. They are confused in terms of how or when that they can apply for relief. And it's just completely arbitrary based on what we're hearing from women who are reporting out.
Okay, thank you so much. And for the sake of my colleagues, I will yield back, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Absolutely, thank you as well. Representative McBath.
Chair and Chairman Nadler, and I just want to give such a heartfelt thanks to each of the panelists that are here with us in the roundtable, and especially to you, Ms. Caldwell. My heart completely goes out to you, and I'm just really just sickened by what we're hearing today. But on May 1st, Attorney General Barr participated in a Q&A on Twitter, and in response to a question from our colleague, Congressman Bobby Rush, Attorney General Barr said that the Department of Justice made sure releases to home confinement would be using authority under the First Step Act. And additional releases to home confinement after Congress gave the Department of Justice new tools in the CARE Act. Attorney General Barr said, and I quote, "We have been using that discretion aggressively. Right now, we have just short of 5,000 in-home confinements, and we have another 1,000 in the pipeline, and we are processing them very quickly. And we do not put out people who are violent offenders or sexual offenders, end quote. So we know that AG Barr has authorized some home confinement, but there are also many more individuals, including those in COVID-19 high-risk groups that are still not, that are still in our federal prisons. That includes not only incarcerated individuals, but also those who are working in the prison, and then they go home to their families out into the community. 196 federal prison staff have tested positive for COVID-19 so far. And as stay-home orders are relaxed or lifted, those staff members are likely to be out in their communities more and more, sometimes possibly without even knowing that they are infected. In the CARES Act that Congress has just passed with bipartisan support in the House and the Senate, and we've actually authorized $100 million to address the health care concerns for our prison population. Mrs. James, from your conversations with incarcerated people, which you've talked about today, what have you learned about how that money is being spent for the protection of both the inmates and the staff?
I can speak to the concerns that we have about the consistency, particularly of people who are terminally ill and very ill and have clearly compromised immune systems, particularly at the medical prison Carswell, where consistently women are not now, since COVID-19, receiving medication, life-saving medication, such as chemotherapy treatments, dialysis, things that are literally necessary on a daily basis for the health and well-being of these women. And that report after report on daily we're receiving are saying that these women are not getting the same level of medical attention or their chemotherapy or other treatments consistently on the schedules that they were accustomed to and were necessary. In addition to that, Congresswoman, in an effort to create some spacing that is literally impossible, federal prisons have taken women who are in lower custody, such as federal prison camps, and they have moved them into higher security prisons, such as FCIs. And as a result of that, there are women who had medications that were allowed in the prison camps that are no longer allowed behind the more secure wall at the FCIs, pumps and things that are necessary for to facilitate breathing and so forth. And so these health conditions are being exacerbated by the poor handling of that the BOP is doing to try and handle COVID-19, when we could be creating the social distancing that is that is necessary by moving through these other three phases that we have outlined that could be happening right now by the Bureau of Prisons to free up space in the Federal Bureau of Prisons.
Thank you very much. Madam Chair, can we have another moment?
Please go ahead.
Thank you so much. And Mrs. Caldwell, what PPE or cleaning supplies have been given to your father and the staff that he interacts with, including medical staff and corrections officers?
I'm not sure I have all the information for you there. I can tell you what my dad has told us. The two things that I've been told are that they are wearing masks, that they get distributed masks once a week. The other thing is that they have painted a red line on their beds to notate where their heads should go. That's it.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. And I yield back the balance of my time.
Hopefully you'll have a chance to explain that a little later. Chairman Jeffries.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Madam Chair, for convening us, and also Chairman Nadler for your leadership. I want to thank all of the guests who are participating in this forum as well for the information that you've provided in such a comprehensive and compelling fashion. The conditions that have been described at this forum are unacceptable, unconscionable, and un-American. The Constitution prohibits any American from being subjected to cruel and unusual punishment. No prison sentence should be a death sentence, but for far too many incarcerated individuals who have died as a result of being infected by COVID-19, that is already the case. That is shameful. So I thank you, Madam Chair, the Honorable Karen Bass, for convening us and for your steadfast advocacy. Mr. Patton, the Attorney General indicated that he was going to encourage the Bureau of Prisons to release medically vulnerable people, and yet the BOP has placed, as far as the numbers that I can tell, less than 3,000 people on home confinement since late March, despite Congress and the CARES Act giving them ample authority to do so. Can you explain why the numbers have been so unacceptably low?
Thank you, Representative Jeffries. I wish I could explain it. I've been shocked by how callous the response has been and the lack of urgency. And I just want to note that the number you just put out, less than 3,000, is in fact the more accurate number. Representative McBath had mentioned Attorney General Barr's tweet about 5,000 people being in home confinement. That's the total number of people in home confinement. That's not the number of people they've moved into home confinement because of COVID-19. So that was a very misleading tweet on his part when he was discussing these issues. I wish I could explain it. You know, here in Brooklyn at the MDC, we had an instance of a Vietnam veteran with all sorts of medical issues who was in on a very low-level drug offense. And we had to pound the table for weeks and weeks and weeks to try to get them to do something. They continually denied us. Eventually we prevailed. So that's one of these less than 3,000 people. You know, it's not as though DOJ is simply, those 3,000 people are people that they willingly identified and got out. It was after weeks and weeks of advocacy. And then when they finally did, they dumped him out of the building. He had a place to stay in Philadelphia. They dumped him out of the building nearly at midnight, even though we'd asked them, please tell us when you're going to release him so we can get this guy home and do it safely. There's just a level, I don't know how else to say it, of callousness and cruelty behind these policies and practices that's really quite shocking.
Yeah, the inhumanity that seems to be on display by some folks within the Bureau of Prisons should shock the conscience of every single American. Just to place the numbers briefly into context, there are about 175,000 or so people currently incarcerated within the federal system. Is that right?
That's correct.
And the vast majority of those individuals are nonviolent drug offenders or nonviolent offenders. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And so clearly over 100,000 individuals fall into the category of being nonviolent and perhaps not presenting a risk to society were they released. Then you have thousands of other individuals who are elderly and not a danger to society. And then you also have thousands of individuals presumably suffering from pre-existing conditions that present a higher degree of risk factor should they be afflicted with COVID-19. And so the Bureau of Prisons needs to do a better job, because what you have done so far is shameful. I'm also thankful for the leadership of Ted Lieu in calling for an inspector general's investigation into what appears to be a disparate policy of treating friends of the administration one way and everyday Americans a different way. So thank you, David, for your leadership. I also want to thank Andrea James and Angela Caldwell for your advocacy and for your compelling presentations today. And Madam Chair, I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. David Cicilline.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I'd like to begin by thanking you and Chairman Nadler and our colleague, Chairman Jeffries, for your heroic leadership on this really critical issue. Thank you to Ms. James for your extraordinary work. Thank you, Ms. Caldwell, for your courage and your willingness to share a very painful story about what you have experienced as a family. And of course, thank you, Mr. Patton, for being a defender of liberty and for being with us today. I think, like my colleagues, hearing these stories about the conditions in which inmates are finding themselves is appalling. And the notion that, as Chairman Jeffrey said, that individuals who are in custody are facing the very real prospect of contracting a deadly virus is something that no one on this committee, no one in the Congress, no one in this country should find acceptable. I have a mother who has COPD, and she lives with my dad, and she's 80 years old. I'm terrified that she would get this virus. I can't imagine what families like Angela's, what their sleepless nights are like. This is something that we have a responsibility to shine a light on, and that's what the purpose of this roundtable is. So my question, Mr. Batten, is, I received a very disturbing email from a family member of someone at Otisville about a just horrible experience in which, just like Ms. Caldwell, they were told a bunch of different things. People were put into some sort of confinement where they were told they'd have to stay for a number of days, almost quarantining within the prison facility before they would be released. And that release was changed. They were returned back to the facility. I mean, the family having no information about what was happening, who's making the decision, what standard is applying. And they recount what we all know about prisons. There's not enough soap. There's virtually no hand sanitizer. There's no program to wipe down telephones or computers. So I'm just wondering, do you have any sense, Mr. Patton, about whether or not there is any compliance in a meaningful way with basic CDC guidelines? And Ms. Caldwell, I ask you the same question, in the facilities that you're familiar with at the Bureau of Prisons.
No, there's not. And I know that because there are numerous lawsuits around the country, including here in New York City, in which judges have having on court-ordered medical inspections. And so here in New York City, at both the MDC and MCC, the former chief medical officer of New York City's correctional health system inspected those facilities. And he used words like alarm and systemic failure. And he ticked off, I believe it was more than 20 basic failings of the sort that you're describing and others. So it's not, you don't have to take my word for it. Real medical experts who have been on the inside and who have reviewed these places are shocked.
And in fact, in some of that litigation, they described the Bureau of Prisons exhibiting deliberate indifference, which is, as you well know, a civil rights standard. So my final question is, you know, what more can Congress do in addition to oversight? Should we contemplate trying to develop a standard that says, you know, that takes away discretion and says, if you have less than, you know, X amount of time left on your sentence, if it is this, if it is, you must be released. If you are determined to have a pre-existing condition, is it to give the courts more discretion? Because relying on the Bureau of Prisons to be the moving party seems absurd. You know, what can we do to protect the lives of individuals who are in custody or under sentence, and to bring some peace of mind to their family members and loved ones, that we as a government will take our responsibility to keep them safe seriously?
I think the provisions in the HEROES Act strike exactly the balance that you're talking about, that do in fact recognize that DOJ and BOP are not doing this of their own accord, and does in fact require the release of certain vulnerable people, acknowledging that there are going to be some people where there are going to be public safety considerations and maybe they won't be released. We're realistic about this, but I think the provisions in the HEROES Act are a terrific first step.
Thank you so much. And with that, Madam Chair, I yield back.
Thank you. Mr. Liu.
I thank you, Chairwoman Bass, for your leadership on this issue. And I want to thank Chairman Nadler for his leadership of the full committee. And thank you to the witnesses for your powerful testimony today. Mr. Patton, you had mentioned in your opening remarks Terminal Island Prison. As you know, that's a facility in Southern California that has approximately a 70% infection rate of COVID-19, and at least 8 inmates have died. There are numerous other prisons, as you noted, that have similar high infection rates with multiple inmates dying. That's one reason that Congresswoman Barragán and I wrote a letter to the Federal Bureau of Prisons asking them to release all inmates into home confinement and to come up with a plan for their other facilities. And it's also why Congressman Jeffries and I wrote a letter to Inspector General asking them to investigate the Bureau of Prison and Department of Justice's inadequate response to the COVID-19 outbreaks. My two questions to you have to do with the legal standard for cruel and unusual punishment. As you know, the first prong that has to be met is that it's an objective standard where there was a substantial risk of serious harm to inmates. So let me ask you, if a prison has approximately 70% of inmates having been infected with a life-threatening virus and 8 inmates having already died, would you say that that could pose a substantial risk of serious harm to the inmates?
Well, given the environment that we're talking about, it certainly does. I don't think there's any question. When you combine that level of infection with the living arrangements in the facilities, the constant close social contact and the lack of appropriate sanitation, that standard is clearly met. And if it's not, it's hard to imagine what would be.
Thank you. In your earlier testimony, you used the word callous to describe the actions and views of the Department of Justice and Federal Bureau of Prisons. So when you've got Terminal Island facility with probably 70% of the inmates being infected, and again, 8 having already died, would you say that the actions of the Department of Justice or the Federal Bureau of Prisons could be deliberately indifferent to the risks posed to prisoners?
Unfortunately, yes. You know, I think we'd all like to believe that responsible officials at a place like the Department of Justice, with justice in the name of it, would act in a more responsible way. But the fact is, they just are not.
And thank you for your answers, because they established cruel and unusual punishment. And I think it's also one reason why a federal judge in Ohio recently found that prisoners who made a cruel and unusual punishment claim at Elkton Prison had a high likelihood of succeeding on their merits. And he ordered the prison officials to essentially release inmates at home confinement. So thank you for your work and for your advocacy. And I believe that the Department of Justice every day now is engaged in cruel and unusual punishment, violating the Constitution, and that is completely unacceptable. My last question goes to Ms. Caldwell. Thank you for your powerful testimony. I just want to confirm that you stated the Federal Bureau of Prisons denied home confinement because they said that your father had not served more than 50% of his sentence. Is that correct?
That is my understanding, yes.
I simply note that Paul Manafort did not serve more than 50% of his sentence, yet he was released by Attorney General Bill Barr. Paul Manafort happens to be the former campaign manager of Donald Trump and is a friend of the president. That is disparate treatment. It's my hope that Inspector General not only looks at his case, but also investigates your father's case. And with that, I will yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Liu. Representative Madeline Dean.
Thank you, Chairwoman Bass. Thank you, Chairman Nadler, for convening this very important and extraordinarily troubling roundtable. I thank you to the experts and the advocates and Ms. Caldwell also very, very much for your extraordinary strength of story and your champion nature for your father. I believe you'll be successful, and it should not take coming. I pray you'll be successful. It should not take coming to us to just reveal the extraordinary inhumanity within the system that seems baked in and covered over and seems unbreakable, but it is breakable. I introduced, and so I would like some reflection on whether you think this is a good idea. I introduced a companion piece of legislation to the CARES Act, the Emergency, GRACE Act that was introduced in the Senate. I have introduced the companion in the House that would allow a breaking through of this system and would allow for the inmate to petition directly to federal courts. And would place requirements on the Bureau of Prisons. Would you, in your anecdotal, very sad story, Ms. Caldwell, believe that that kind of relief would be helpful to you and your family?
100% absolutely that would be helpful to my family. We have been spending the past 2 months, as a matter of fact, trying to figure out a route to the sentencing judge. I can't say that that would be helpful for every family. I know that some of the sentencing judges are not as kind.
Ms. James, would you have a comment on the GRACE Act?
Yes, Congresswoman, absolutely. The streamlining of the compassionate release process would be incredibly helpful. We know that, again, the standard for granting compassionate release is very high. It's an extraordinary and compelling. The exhaustion requirement makes compassionate release essentially unobtainable. And so we need the GRACE Act to streamline that process.
And I think it's aptly named, because sometimes you just have to apply grace. You have to rise above the inhumanity and the so-called justice. And as Shakespeare said, offer grace. I hope we'll be successful in getting that passed. Mr. Patton, David, do you have an opinion on that?
I'm well aware of the GRACE Act and your work, Representative Dean, and we're grateful to you for it. It would be a huge step forward if we could get it passed.
I'm worried too, Mr. Patton, about folks in the justice system or coming into the justice system and access to public defenders. Are we finding that folks are struggling to have representation as a result of this pandemic?
It's an enormous challenge because you have 170 plus thousand people incarcerated. Many of them, their cases have long been over. They don't have an active attorney on their case. Their attorney may be long gone, may be retired, may no longer be in practice. And so I know that my colleagues and myself around the country are making enormous efforts to identify people who need assistance, but it's a huge undertaking. Great, terrific groups like Families Against Mandatory Minimums and the National Association of Criminal Defense Lawyers and others are really pitching in with big pro bono efforts to try to identify people and get them represented. But it's a big challenge.
And I hear my time has expired. Ms. James, at some point, I'd love to connect with you regarding Muncie Prison, Pennsylvania Prison for Women. I'd love
Certainly. To. We are actively engaged in that. Thank you,
Representative Carcel Powell.
Yes, thank you so much, Chairwoman Bass, Chairman Nadler, for having this conversation. You know, we have been now for weeks on our calls, the Democratic Caucus, talking about how COVID-19 has really shown the inequities in our communities. And where we've seen a huge rise in cases has been in prisons, in nursing homes, and communities of color. And we need to, first of all, I agree wholeheartedly with what my colleague Hakeem Jeffries said earlier. Every person deserves to be treated with dignity and respect. And we have the right and the responsibility to do that. I want to commend Angela. Your story really, really struck a chord. And I'm so grateful that you are here with us today, because people need to hear from family members. Your father is in a low security prison, first offender, 65 years old. He should be at home confinement. And that's not only the moral thing to do, but it's the right thing to do for the safety of our community. We have a serious pandemic right now in the United States, and having safe policies is also the right thing to do for the safety of our community. I want to just bring attention to actually a state correctional system. It's the Homestead Correctional Institution here in my district. It's a state-run women's prison, but they've really felt a severe impact of COVID-19. There are now 231 inmates, 35% of the facility's population have tested positive. Over 300 are in quarantine, and actually over 20 staff members have tested positive. And even though they knew that COVID-19 was a threat, they did not start implementing any measures until they had 73 inmates who had already tested positive. I want to start with my first question with Andrea, if you can, since you mentioned the women's prison. What do you think, how have you seen, what are the unique challenges that the women's correctional institutions face during the COVID-19 pandemic? And what do you recommend that we need to do and protect these women at these facilities?
Well, certainly we are very concerned about there being no special attention provided for elderly women with compromised immune systems and pregnant women. We've already seen, and we have been mourning still, the unnecessary death of Andrea Circlebear. And there are countless women, Lisa Crow right now, who we are fighting to get out of Caswell. She is dying. She is literally dying of stage 4 cancer. She is metastasized. She has a lump in her throat. She is choking on her own saliva as we speak. And we still cannot get her out. And there are many reasons that we don't pay attention to that land women in general on a prison bunk. Most of it is attributable to sexual violence, untreated trauma, the illness of addiction. And these are things that will never, ever, because of the culture of incarceration, be effectively addressed by a prison environment, particularly women who are struggling from sexual trauma. So we need to change some of the things that we're doing in terms of who we're using incarceration for, and particularly pay special attention to the reasons why, the studies that we have done at the National Council to demonstrate why women land on a prison bunk, and all of the work we have done to create alternatives to that, that keep women in their communities. And I'll end here also by saying 85%+ of incarcerated women are mothers. They are mothers of children under the age of 18. Their separation from their children has caused further harm. We have to do a better job in this country and figure out ways to really begin to stop incarcerating people for things that people just should not be in prisons for.
Thank you. Thank you, Andrea. I wholeheartedly agree. Now, at the federal level, you know that my colleagues and I have really been pushing the Trump administration to protect the people that have been incarcerated in federal prisons. And actually, Representative Val Demings and myself, we signed and sent a letter directly to Attorney General William Barr, demanding, and to the BOP, demanding answers about the protocols in place and the resources that have been given to the federal facilities here in Florida. But of course, we have not received any response. So you can imagine, Andrea, as you were mentioning, you're not getting any responses. They're even blocking responses to us, members of Congress. Now, in my district, we also have a federal correctional facility that houses over 1,000 inmates. And I've been receiving calls that inmates and staff members still do not have the proper PPE equipment, even when they're transferring some of these incarcerated individuals to a hospital when they need care, they're not given the proper PPE equipment. And I know that that is really putting the safety of our communities at stake. So I give this question to David, to Andrea, to Angela, whoever wants to answer, but how do you think this is actually affecting the health and the safety of our communities when we're not actually protecting those people that are in our federal prisons by providing that equipment, by providing the necessary sanitation measures?
I would ask that you, if you guys are gonna respond, you respond quickly because we're out of time.
I'll just say very quickly, when you have a hotbed of infection, they're not walled off from society. You have dozens and hundreds of staff in and out of those facilities every single day. What's going on in those facilities impacts the community at large.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Representative Steve Cohen.
I'm unmuted. Am I videoed in?
Yes, we can see you and hear you.
Thank you, Chairwoman Bass, for holding this hearing. It's so important. Now, I had a letter from a lady who's not in my district. She was from Lenoir City, and it was about her husband, and a long way from me. And he's 73 years old. He had a heart transplant due to cardiomyopathy, and he was 69 at that time. He's now 73. So he's in some serious medical conditions and vulnerable, and he served over half his time, and yet he hasn't been released. He's in Lexington, or been considered, I guess. He's up in Lexington, Kentucky, I believe. It just seems like this is so dependent on whether you're a friend of President Trump's or not. Does anybody there, and I guess Mr. Patton might be the right person to ask, how many people at Michael Cohen's prison and at Manafort's prison had been diagnosed with COVID-19?
I don't have those numbers in front of me. I'm afraid I can pull them up and probably have them to you before we finish this hearing.
I can say that I've read thoroughly about this, is that there were no one who had COVID-19 at Paul Manafort's, and I don't think Cohen's was any different. And they got out. Now, Manafort was under 50%. Do you have any idea the percentage of people who've gotten out when they hadn't met the criteria of 50% or more time served?
I don't, but it's not a large number for sure. I think it's a very small number. One thing I just want us to be careful about, when we say that there are no, I understand the point you're making, which is a very good one, that there seems to be disparate treatment going on here. And I think that's surely the case. But I would be very hesitant to say that there is any facility without COVID-19. They are intentionally not testing people. The testing numbers are minuscule. And so even at facilities where there are no positive tests, it likely is rampant in the facility.
There was a case I read about also, I think in California, and it was a man who I think died in imprisonment from getting COVID-19, and he was in there for a DUI, maybe a multiple, I have to imagine, and he didn't have a driver's license. But nevertheless, he was in prison, and just the article I read on that said that everybody basically in his cell block had tested positive. So they tested enough there to know that most of the people in that facility in California had COVID, didn't transfer him. He's in there for a DUI, multiple, so maybe, I don't know, I just saw DUI and not having a license. That's no reason to sentence somebody to death. That's what they're doing by leaving people in there. It's cruel and inhuman, as Congressman Jeffries made clear, and it's also a denial of due process. And I don't know if you could pierce the corporate veil, but that's the kind of negligence that damages should be available. But you can't do anything pipe, and they cause people to lose their lives. It seems to be callous. Got to realize this is the same Bureau of Prisons that didn't guard Jeffrey Epstein, who was the most vulnerable suspect inmate in the country, and they let two guys go to sleep, haven't really followed up on it, and let him commit suicide, allegedly. They haven't found out who helped him commit suicide yet, except the Bureau of Prisons. And with that, I thank you for your testimony. I'm so sorry about your situation, Ms. Caldwell. But this is this administration. This administration is heartless, and they don't care about justice, fairness, or equity. People who are in there of a certain age and served a certain time should all be released. Compassionate release should get them all out, people over a certain age and or with certain medical conditions. But with that, I yield back the balance of my time and thank all the members for participating.
Well, thank you very much, Representative Cohen. And I want to thank our guests today for participating in the roundtable. You know, when we have the discussion about testing, whether there is testing or not, as David Patton was describing, it's really consistent with the administration's policies and magical thinking, in the sense that, you know, you won't find COVID if you don't test. And so why would you test? Because then if you test, you have to do something. And I guess I would just like to know, and maybe we can close out this way. I'll ask my questions and each of you can respond and give any closing comments that you might have. You know, we had a couple of phone conversations with the BOP, and I raised specifically this back and forth where inmates are told, you know, you're going to be released, and then at the last minute the families are ready and everything. I mean, like what Angela described, and each of you described examples of that. And basically, they just described there being misunderstandings. I haven't heard of any of the facilities that actually are performing okay, and I wondered if you had any examples of where the prisons, an individual facility, was actually performing in a good way, either testing, early release, et cetera, if you could give any examples. And then, Andrea, you've mentioned several times the woman who has metastatic cancer, and it almost was as though you didn't describe any treatment or any health care she had at all. They just decided she's on hospice and they're letting her die. I was wondering if you could respond to that. So I would just ask you if each of you would respond, and we'll use those as closing comments. Want to start with Ms. James?
Certainly, Congresswoman, thank you. Lisa is dying, and lots of advocacy from lots of groups she's received. We're just getting regular updates. We anticipated that she would be released, and she has been receiving chemotherapy. She is also one of the people that we have heard that the level of receiving chemotherapy and the timing of that has been altered since COVID-19, like many, many reports coming out of the medical prison at Carswell. And so we're concerned. We're just holding on, holding our breath, hoping for the best for her, that she will be allowed to be with her family on her during her last days. It is that critical. And so I also just wanted to point out, in terms of your other part of your question quickly, that we haven't heard of actual entire prisons that are doing a better job, but we do every now and then get letters like this one here that came in today from the women in Dublin who are talking about individual case managers who are being compassionate. Most of the reports, too many reports are coming in that case managers are being dismissive and that are ignoring them and not going out to really provide them with care. But we do, Congresswoman, hear every now and then that there are case managers, individuals who are working very hard to do everything that they can to at least assist the women in filing their paperwork and hearing and learning about whatever they can to get relief.
Thank you very much. Angela Caldwell?
I didn't prepare closing comments.
Oh,
however,
your thoughts?
I have some. As I'm listening, I'm heartened to hear about some of the efforts that you have, that many of you have put forward. And I know that there's a larger discussion about how we need to do more. I don't like that. I think do more is vague. I think there should be specific action. I think I want, as a citizen, as a normal, regular family member, I want you to open a massive investigation. I want you to press criminal charges against the officials of the BOP. And this is not negligence. This is intentional cruelty. I want you to ask for resignations. I want there to be specific actions taken to hold them accountable.
Thank you. Thank you very much. David Patton, before you answer, I also wanted to know if you have any history of working with the staff or the guards, because this problem is impacting them, obviously. So I wanted to know what the relationship was there.
It is impacting them, Chair. You're exactly right. And they themselves have been quite vocal and active. There have been OSHA complaints, and we hear directly from corrections officers who have many of the same concerns that we do. This is impacting everybody in the system. I'll close by saying this. The COVID-19 issues are going to be with us for quite some time. This isn't disappearing as we move towards reopening society in whatever steps we go through. And as awful as the response has been thus far, it is not too late to save an awful lot of lives, an awful lot of lives who pose no threat to society. There are somewhere between 50 and 60,000 people in the Federal Bureau of Prisons custody who either by age or medical condition are particularly vulnerable. and it's not too late to save them. And steps like the GRACE Act or the provisions in the HEROES Act, if we can actually roll up our sleeves and get those things done, we can in fact save lives.
Thank you so much. And let me just conclude by saying that we sit on the verge of a tragic milestone. Within a few days, we know we'll hit 100,000 dead Americans. And an administration that seems to believe that this is just a part of businesses. And as a matter of fact, we're supposed to congratulate them that it's not more than that. And knowing that prisons, in my opinion, are petri dishes, and people seem to have a very clear understanding of the dangers of a nursing home, but do not seem to have that same understanding where the conditions are far worse, and people do not have the capacity to even have basic hygiene in many, many instances, that folks are going to die, and that those people who work in the prison are going to leave the prison and go to their communities. And so how we stop this cycle, I don't know. I just want to thank our guests very much. You know, we've done this several times now. I appreciate you cooperating every time, but I just think it's so important that people hear the stories, because in many instances, folks that are incarcerated, unless you come from an impacted community, it's an invisible population. And it's just absolutely unacceptable and cruel. Thank you so much. This concludes our roundtable. I want to thank the members. I want to thank our committee chair and other leaders. Thank you so much.